Consultant and PhD researcher, actually starting to do research on our concept, method, improvisational dialogue. Yeah.
My name is Thomas, and I'm a saxophone player and have been all my life, but I'm also a composer for television and films, working right now on an American television show. But yeah, long story short.
A meeting between improvisation from mainly jazz and dialogue in the sense of communication between us as human beings. And what we do, we actually go into organizations and we try to inspire but also solve problems for organizations by using the communications and the interactions of when jazz musicians, they actually engage and come together for playing music. And it's our experience that organizations have a lot to gain and learn from music, from improvisation. That's what at least what we argue, and also I think we can say we experience that people, they tap into to this kind of the same mindset. We like to have a creative mindset. Well, we actually like to take the metaphor of improvisation from jazz to the next level and say, well, actually, we're enabling that you are to be improvisational in your organizations and your interactions. But you need to be more aware of how do you communicate, how do you interact. But especially about the communication, I would say it's a. Is where we actually make this translation into organizations. So what are some of the main topics, main issues from jazz we can take and actually learn from? So what do you think is, what's your experience with?
Well, one of the key skills for jazz musicians is first of all, you of course have to be able to play, but when all this is together, you have to listen. And you have to start to listen and be able to keep your own focus, but also move your focus and listen to what is happening. And this was a little bit what we tried to do right now, creating the same situation, but in two different contexts. Your little solo in the beginning, and then afterwards a duet.
Yeah.
But listening, and of course be able to grab ideas from others. Somebody saying something, take it up, take it into your domain, and throw it out again, and so on and so on.
Okay. So what you're saying is that one thing is to listen, but another thing is also to I'd say what you did actually was my first solo. I was alone, so to speak.
Yeah.
You know, nobody helped me. But my experience is with when you actually now it's we have two saxophones today, and it's a kind of not a usual setting. So Thomas actually stepped into a kind of different role and acted as a bass player.
Normally we have a group and we come in here and we have a bass player that's usually the tiniest setup.
Yeah.
But today I had, and that's also a part of this idea that you have to be able to use your skills. And so I had to take the bass player part.
Mm.
So for your music to make sense in another way, I created the framework we were playing in around you, and then you did not the same, but
exactly.
It was like a conversation. You're talking in this of the same subject, but of course you can use the same word in the same in the same without reading something. So
yeah, actually this is one of the phrases we use, that we would like to create different organizational dialogues. And I also have to say that it's my experience, this is it's a challenge for a lot of organizations, especially from large organizations having or wanting to be creative in an interdisciplinary sense. And this is actually where we use the jazz as a metaphor, but also taking the idea of the jam session to say, okay, now you come from different departments, you have a lot of knowledge, we bring you together and we have this expectation that we would like you to be creative and maybe in the end also be innovative. For now, putting on another buzzword.
Mm-hmm.
And this is actually sometimes, speaking of helping each other, I would say, sometimes, a lot of time, I experience this, that when you're in an organization, you have your own agenda. So when I come to a meeting, I have my own agenda. Maybe my performance is being measured from Fleming. What are you achieving from? What's in it for me at this meeting? So I would be maybe very much concerned or occupied by what's in it for me. We talk about this in jazz. If you have this kind of mindset when you enter into an improvisational setting in a jazz context, well, it's kind of difficult to be strategic, I think, terms or what?
Yo, terrible, and you get this kind of performance where you have what you usually call a show-off.
Okay.
Mm.
You frame a certain artist and you say, okay, you can do all your baboon spring, you can jump up and make yourself a Matela and all
yeah.
that kind of stuff, and everybody, and we just look at you with a great.
Yeah.
And that's a whole different. Of course, you can have a value system that says this is great, but if you really want to create an improvisational musical contest which is rich and what you say flowering and creates new and unexpected opportunities,
mm.
that's not the way to do it.
Okay. So the way is to one of the ways is to actually have a more what holistic sense of what's going on instead of a very individual or self-centered. Or,
You have to have a consciousness regarding the team.
Okay.
And of course you have a success criteria for this activity.
Mm.
And in music. The criteria is an aesthetic goal, and to kind of translate that into organizational is of course a piece of work which you have to do, but the way you achieve this is that you sometimes has to play the other person's better.
Okay.
You have to be a part of racing because maybe you get another turn and maybe you and the whole thing will create a performance which is.
Yeah, that's we've been doing this in organizations, trying to use the music and the jazz as a leverage for teams to say that to practice the ability to actually say now the shifting of supporting each other. Well, now it's my turn to speak. I'll speak up. I'll be saying my thing, so to speak. But when I'm not doing that, from a creative sense, then I'm actually supporting the one speaking. So how can I do that and so forth? That's what we're working with, trying to make this translation from the music to the dialogue. Yes. What we also do is we try to kind of describe and talk about what's going on in music in terms of values, for instance. Trying to say, is there a kind of norm for entering, speaking of context? Musicians, they have, and especially in jazz, we have this concept of jam sessions, meaning that we could go from here to Toronto and we could go into a setting and we could listen to what's going on, and maybe we would recognize something, maybe we would not recognize something, but there are, it's some kind of, to a certain level, maybe institutionalized that there's a opening for inviting people into the setting and say, okay, come and join us. So what are the values, so to speak, present at for instance, at a jam session? What's your experience of that?
Yeah, jam session, that's a tough scene, because it's yeah, it's a big subject actually, because there's of course rules, that's almost tribal.
Exactly.
Tribal rules,
culture.
which is you have to be able to communicate in certain codes, mm-hmm. and you cannot just be, but if you can be the one, you and can actually say the right thing at the right spot and show that you're able to grasp this concept, mm-hmm. you will be invited in, and then you can contribute.
So what you're saying actually is it's very context dependent,
extremely
tribal, as you say.
Yeah,
maybe
yeah.
That's so either you're a part of it or you're not part of it.
Yeah.
Either you be excluded or included, depending on the whether you fit or not fit.
That would be very fast. You will have some indications of which kind of musician you are, and the key players in this situation will very fast say, okay, we are on this level,
mm.
this is not interesting. So they will just
turn the back to you.
Yeah, they'll just make something so another one can come in and maybe bring more to the table. And then, so you are very much aware of this kind of value.
Okay.
Is it raising or is it falling? If it's falling too much, the kind of vibration, the intensity of the situation will everybody can feel, oh shit, we're falling.
Mm.
Out next.
Okay.
Now we go up again. So it's also a certain measuring of energy, which you can say is because in creativity and when you create, it's also an energetic thing. You have to, and there has to be the right people.
Mm-hmm. But this is, we use this as a story, a metaphor, a picture, an analogy for saying that what's in organizations, how aware, how conscious are you actually about what's going on in your typically interdisciplinary teams and the gatherings or the tribes, so to speak? What are the unknown, unspoken, not explicit codes of your culture? Am I able to actually join in a team setting of maybe a creation of something, a creative process or whatever? Or is it tribal, as you say, and so forth? But what about the, you mentioned a little bit about the skills, the mastering, the professionalism or so forth. We talk about that also in organizations. Yes, you need to have knowledge about your specific area of whatever you're doing. I'm just going to pick up the I remember. And it's, we get the question a lot in organizations when they ask, okay, now you're going to join us and we're going to do this thing and so forth. Are we going to play an instrument? No. And that's a very deliberate choice we made, because what we have over time has experienced makes sense for people not being musicians is that, well, you have to play your instrument that you know the best, and that's actually your knowledge. But you need to take your knowledge and put it into play in a different way. And that's what we are saying, that okay, so it's back to the dialogue. It's what you're saying, how you're saying it, and so forth, together with others. That's actually at stake here, I would say.
Yeah.
Okay, I think we elaborate a little bit on context, but I think we just take this this slide here. maybe Tom, you can say, who's this guy?
Anyone know Charles Mingus? Maybe not, but he's one of these Afro-American orchestra leader, bass player, and but also a composer and band leader from the 40s and the 50s and early 60s as well. And yeah, one of the carrier of the torch, of the jazz torch, and he said that.
Yeah, and actually this quote is from it's actually from a kind of jam session many years ago. Mm-hmm. And the bass player, there was a young alto player entering the stage, and Mingus was actually kind of shouting this to this guy. And they were playing, I think, a couple of nights in a row. And what happened is,
he was known as a very violent,
very
aggressive man. So the drummer actually always, there's a story saying that the drummer took his gun out, everybody had a gun, and put it on this one drum, and then he looked at, okay, one, two. And he always looked up, where is Charles Mingus?
Because but the reason actually the story goes is this alto player, they were playing three nights in a row or so, and I think maybe on the second or the third night or so, he shouted to the alto player this because he was repeating himself. So we're back to actually also about knowledge, I would say, in organizations. Okay, you know something, that's whatever skill or competences you might have in what you're doing, that's great. You're producing whatever you're doing. But if, in terms of being creative, the argument is that you need to transcend your own knowledge, so to speak. You need to be, I would say, open, sensible for, sensitive for whatever is happening. And that's what Mingus is also stating here, that you need to have a frame to do this, a kind of framework. And that's also what we're doing in organizations. We're trying to challenge the organizations to become aware of. Now you're entering a meeting, and the framework in a meeting is typically, probably a lot of you know this, is an agenda. We have an agenda. And we also have agendas in music. Actually, what we played early was a blues, an F, so there's a framework, but maybe it's so tacit in a sense, for we know this, but maybe you don't know that. So what we're trying to what we're doing in organizations is create this awareness of what do you want to accomplish in a meeting? What is your framework, and how is your framework actually hampering or enhancing or supporting the creative process within the dialogue? And this is actually where we use this as a set off to talk about and to show. We do it with some of the other guys.
Yeah.
We use this as a again picture or we show it, and you can of course, you can try to hear what's going on. And some would say that the framework, this is something that Mingus is talking about, is when are you actually, typically in an organizational setting, as a leader or as a band leader, when do you allow for the framework or the something to be challenged? Or when do you expect that this is the boundaries and you need to stick inside the box, or so to speak, or within the boundaries?
Yeah.
And this is actually very, very difficult for a lot of organizations to say, do we allow this kind of autonomy or the very free settings, frameworks?
Yeah, it's difficult. I remember trying this situation with, I was playing with a group, and suddenly we played a tune we had played a lot of times, but the guys in the band has developed a skill I wasn't able to log into. So suddenly they played such complex backing for my solo, so I didn't actually know what the fuck was going on. I could just say, okay, and you just play along, and then I stood back, and I I was recording it so I could go home backwards, and I could listen to it, and I could see, wow, I'm totally out. But I don't think that the audience necessarily could detect that I was out of it. But the thing was that the piano player, instead of the grouping of four, which is a very common thing in music that you divide, he just had practiced to divide it in five. So everything suddenly became five, which suddenly changed the whole scene. And these skills suddenly, he said something in the process. And it was my group, I was the leader. Suddenly his knowledge brought me out of it. And
excluded you.
He actually excluded my situation, and he made me look really, in my own opinion, fucked up. So I called him and said, what's going on? Well, he was bored, you know. Fair enough.
Okay.
And so, again, how can we, how do we learn to, because he's a skilled guy. I would like to have him in my band, but he had to make, but we had to work on the attitude, and we maybe had to work for, that he was maybe working for the whole concept, because
exactly.
Suddenly, his knowledge wasn't what gave making the good thoughts for us all.
I remember you used the phrase, it's your name on the poster, and you were kind of sidelined.
Exactly. Okay. But again, as you mentioned before, we all, certain branches, more or less, for example, if you suddenly have engineers or programmers who do apps or whatever, you need these guys. You need them to be able to suddenly take off. And how do you do that? And how do you communicate with them?
Well, this is actually, I would say, I could pick up on what organizations is very concerned with in different levels of, you can say, that's uncertainty, for instance,
exactly.
And complexity.
Yeah.
But actually, this is a kind of, I would say, a picture on complexity in a sense,
exactly.
Where you're not able to pick up on the complexity in that context.
Nope.
And get excluded, because you didn't practice it. So. but the uncertainty of not knowing what is the outcome going to be for what from what we are doing, that's a lot of organizations are trying to cope with that, and that's also what we're trying to do. And there's the thing going on, it's not very new. In my experience is that larger organizations, they would like to have the metaphor of they have a mothership and then they have speedboat, and the speedboat is the metaphor for the experimental and the creative smaller organization. And then when they have figured out what to do and this is the new thing, the blah blah blah, and they'll go back to the mothership and then everything is great. And that's, it sounds very 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 easy, but it's actually very 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 difficult. And that is also what we're trying to do, to work with the mindset, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So what does it take actually to both be able to, as a mothership, to if that's the kind of process going on, but more into being the speedboat. So what's going on in the speedboat, so to speak? That's what we're also doing, trying to do as well. Yeah. So how are we on time? We're a little bit.
5-10 minutes.
5 minutes or more, okay. So if we have to say something about our experiences is that it's actually a concept that organizations and the people working in the organizations, and to a certain extent, maybe mostly the leaders, they're not aware of. And that's the thing that we do in music, we practice. And practice is actually, I would say, it's not something that a lot of organizations are concerned with. We had a joke, I remember, when we were younger. And that was that if we were paid for practicing, we would be millionaires today.
Yeah.
We made jokes about that. But I think the story is interesting, because I think, from my experience, organizations, they want to have the quick fixes. They don't want to practice, actually. And fail, and failure is also, or making flaws into the music is especially in jazz, we try to pick up on that as well in the dialogue. Well, you need to be in a kind of space for where you can make mistakes, you can experiment, and I can say something that's totally ridiculous and so forth. But it's in jazz, we use it as a stepstone actually to say, okay, something wrong happened, but I need to be able to pick up on that and make sense of out of that on my instrument.
Yeah, and it's not, you also say in jazz, you say that one thing that you are extremely skilled, you can be extremely skilled on your instrument, your knowledge, but you have to practice just as much the actual interaction. You have to actually practice improvising for being better to improvise. Because if you don't do that, then you have to practice the mindset. And as another very famous musician said, Miles Davis, who was looking for failure, he said, I don't know if he just used this term, but that was his opinion, that this for him was the God's finger. When something played a wrong note, he said, it's not the actual fault, but it's the next note after that who decides if it was a failure. So if my band or my organization can adjust to this, then suddenly it was just a turn and we are on a new direction. And again,
I think it's a great illustration of the setting or the context or the room or space for actually allowing for making mistakes and so forth. But making mistakes, in my experience, is also some organizations, they actually, in speaking of culture and mindset, way of thinking, we did a research project in a high-tech engineering company, and they were the management were very concerned, what is the reason for the employees of this department do not make experiments on own initiative? And it turned out that they were afraid of making mistakes. And a lot of reason for, one of the reasons was actually they were making experimenting in real time objects, which were very costly. So if they made a mistake, it would be so expensive. So they needed to adjust their way of experimenting in the sense of using other materials, doing prototyping, whatever, a more plain culture and so forth, making mistakes without having the huge costs of making mistakes.
Yeah.
But the question is, we're working with, when are we making mistakes in our dialogues? Who's to determine when I'm saying something wrong? Again, I would say we're maybe back to the framework also of what we're doing and the context.
The anxiety of making this fall can make you sink back in your key knowledge, and you stick to your you stick to your good licks. We call it licks in music. That exactly this guy who repeats himself all the time. This guy coming in, always saying the same, always have the same opinions. But in order to be able to not sink deep in your knowledge, but to always be open-minded and accomplish that your knowledge is put in play. That's the exactly what we look for. But maybe we are.
Yeah.
That was. It's time for.